Thank you all very much, and I want you to join me in welcoming Dr. Maguire.
Oh, thank you, Heather. Honored to be here. Thank you so much, and great to see so many friendly faces. You're probably wondering how I got interested in stuttering, right? You're probably wondering. It began about age 3 when I began to talk. And I noticed, hey, what's going on really in my brain, right? And stuttering is something that I've had it, even though we've only slated an hour for this, well, I just know it's going to take about 4.5 hours for me to go through the slides. And no, I mean, you're going to be here, you only get an hour's worth of credit, and there's no more food or anything like that. So with it, stuttering does run in families. My brother, who since passed away, he also stuttered. My mother's brother stuttered as well, too. Then kind of learning a little bit more of that. My relatives from southern Italy learned that there's quite a few individuals who stutter over there, too. So it's been something with me. I kind of grew up, and that really led me to go into medical school at some point, is to figure out what was really going on in my brain and what was it. So I'll give you kind of a background on a personal journey, how we've kind of arrived at these treatments that we have, potentially for folks who stutter, and some of the ethical dilemmas that we have in actually bringing these treatments actually to full-fledged use with that as well, too. I'm going to do some disclosures. I'm on the speaker's bureau. These all go through UCR. Not any of these groups are supporting work in stuttering. This is for some other research. These are my research grants that Heather's seen through. This Cyanon is sponsoring, in some way, our newest study in stuttering that's being supported actually by a philanthropic donation, but they're providing the medications for the ECO-PIPAM study that we'll get through that. Also, from disclosure, I'll talk to you about treatments for stuttering. But there are no treatments that are actually FDA approved by the government for this disorder. So this is a disorder that there is no treatment that's approved by the government that's gone through that process, and that's where we're going to talk about that. How does it actually take to get a medication through the FDA process in order to be approved by the government for that? Stutterings occurred throughout history, recorded history. There's an ancient Egyptian hieroglyphic for stuttering. So this is not a new disorder that psychiatry just thought of. But sometimes psychiatry, as a field, we get criticized for thinking of conditions that maybe people say, well, this is just part of human nature. But stutterings occurred throughout history. There's actually an ancient Greek orator, Demosthenes was his name. And Demosthenes was a Greek orator, and he learned that he stuttered, and he learned to speak fluently to the rhythm of the waves, and he put rocks in his mouth, and he learned, he writes about his own stuttering with that as well, too. Every language has a word for stuttering as well. I only speak one of these, so I have to ask my daughter what these other ones are, because she speaks languages. But every language has a word for stuttering. Like I said, it's occurred throughout recorded history as well. Psychiatry is classified in the DSM, which is the Psychiatric Diagnostic Criteria, as a disorder, as an Access 1 condition. So it is a diagnosable disorder. It can be treated through various different means, through speech therapy and other things with it. This was the old criteria that came off of the old book, DSM-4. I worked on the revised criteria. I was on the task force of the revised criteria, kind of review that. But still pretty much this is what is there, which is that stuttering is a disturbance of the normal fluency and time patterning of speech, which is inappropriate for the individual's age, because you might have a little child age 2, 2.5, maybe stuttering a little bit. It's characterized by sound and syllable repetitions, sound prolongations, interjections or ums and ahs within the word, broken words where they stop and have a pause within a word, audible or silent blocking, filled or unfilled pauses in speech, word substitutions to avoid the problematic words. I was a king of this as a little boy. When I was in kindergarten, the teacher gave me an assignment. Please give us a report to all kids and talk about your brothers and sisters. And I knew I stuttered on the word brother. So I said, I got to get in front of this class. I'm 5 years old. I got to say, I've got 3 brothers. I'm not going to get around this. So here I am, 5 years old, and I discover a book. It's a great book. It's called A Thesaurus. Right? So I found this book. I was a little boy, and I look up brother. And I said, a male sibling. I'm like, yes. So I'm in class, and I say, I have 4 siblings, 3 boys and 1 girl. Very good. So I learned the substitute even in kindergarten with that. Words produced with an excess of physical tension and whole word repetitions, and it can interfere with one's academic or occupational achievement as well. I know individuals who avoid certain jobs. I was told as a medical student, don't be a psychiatrist. It's the most verbal field. You're going to fail at that. You're going to make your patients uncomfortable. you should be a radiologist. I didn't like sitting in the dark room, so I'm like, I'm not going to be a radiologist. Or you should be a pathologist, and I didn't want to deal with dead. I want to deal with people alive, so I didn't want to do with that. So I kind of proved to other people that this is the field that I really wanted to do, and I kind of had to follow my dream with it. But also taught me another thing, too. One of my very first patients I had, I was in training as a psychotherapist, which every psychiatrist has to do. And this is a patient of mine in Orange County where I trained at UC Irvine, and she was lost her job, she had divorced, she could no longer afford the high-powered psychiatrist that was probably $300 an hour back then to pay him, so she had to come to a teaching clinic and see me for about $20 an hour, right? So here's the very first day, I'm interviewing her, I'm stuttering a great deal before I was on treatment, I'm stuttering, I'm sure in the back of her mind she thought, great, this is what I get for $20. I get a guy who stutters. I'm like, I'm really failing. I don't know if I can really do this. I'm doing talk therapy. I'm a person who stutters. At the end of the hour, she said, Dr. Maguire, I think I'm going to like working with you because I see you struggle with something your whole life, so maybe you can understand what I've been going through. I'm like, I should have paid her $20, right? Because she made me feel so much better with that. So it shows you it's really that people who stutter can still communicate well. There's so much more to communication besides the verbal speech with it. So we revised the criteria in DSM-5 a few years ago. We added avoidance. Many people who stutter avoid, they have anxiety around certain situations. They avoid certain situations or certain words. So we added that could be central feature to the disorder as well. We removed interjections. And I did this because I was watching Sandra Bullock's husband at the time. You know that guy? What was his name? Kind of that. Jesse James. Yes, I was watching him on Larry King. And I was inspired by him because he was being interviewed by Larry King, and interjections are like ums and ahs. And I was watching him, and he's like, well, I met Sandy, and you know, like, she was pretty hot and stuff, and I thought, you know, like, I don't know, like, maybe, you know, maybe, like, I asked her out or something. I'm like, I don't want this guy listed in my group, right? So I took him out, right? So I took out Sandra Bullock's husband. At the time, it was probably a pretty good move. So we removed interjections. I really thought it's true. Other people have interjections, but they don't stutter. So it would be something that people, that many people who stutter have interjections, but many people with interjections don't stutter. We talked about a differentiation of stuttering that begins in childhood. It's a different disorder that begins in childhood. It's developmental of origin. We don't know exactly the reasons why. We're going to talk about that a little bit more. Then stuttering that begins in late life. Or in later life. That can be related to trauma, medications, other things with it. There's also some terms of psychogenic stuttering, which was a term we actually thought this is better termed in malingering. If a patient is like we've had some cases where individuals claim stuttering, but they're going for a lawsuit or a workers' comp claim or other things with that. And we place that in another section with that. It's 1% of the population. This is a common disorder. It's 1% of the population. It's more common in kids. About 80% of children will outgrow stuttering. There's about 5 million Americans stutter, and our membership of the National Stuttering Association doesn't even come close to reaching that. We're doing our part to reach people. There are many people who stutter, who suffer in silence with this disorder. Now, there have been historical theories to the treatment of stuttering going way back to the ancient Greeks and so forth about cauterizing or cutting the tongue, and this is real. You think this is barbaric? There was actually a child who was referred to me from Pakistan at one point about 15 years ago, and his brother actually had his tongue cauterized. He stuttered. Then this little boy, the parents said, we're not going to do that. We're going to bring him to America and be treated. So it's still going on. There's still some areas where the understanding of this are putting rocks in your mouth. Have you ever seen the movie King George VI? There's a beginning scene there where they actually wanted him to put the marbles in his mouth. That came from Demosthenes, the ancient Greek orator, as being that sort of treatment. Heather, we're not doing that study here at UCR. I just want you to know that is not. I have not submitted that to the IRB. That would not go through. I haven't done that. There's an interesting. This was an NIH study in the 90s about Botox injections. They were injecting Botox into the laryngeal folds of people who stutter. They didn't stutter anymore, but they couldn't talk. It was really not that effective. They didn't really work. So that's another. So that was really looking at the tongue and throat being the problem. But actually, and Ian really only wanted me to present the most up-to-date literature, so I did. I found an article from 1927, so I had to find something that was older than my father. And this was a study, it was actually, they were on the right track. It was Travis and Orton, who were a speech-language pathologist and a neurologist, got together, and they really believed that stuttering was a disorder of the brain. It was a disorder where they looked, they observed people who stutter, and they had differences in cross-handedness. They might bat a ball with their right hand, but kick a ball with their left foot, or they saw these differences in the left-right of the dominance, and they really believed that stuttering was brought about by this incomplete dominance of the speech centers. And they were really on the right track. Now we are here 90 years later, we're coming back to them saying, you know, these guys were really on the right track. We got derailed for a little bit. The psychoanalysts took over. These were the Freudian-type folks in psychiatry. They came up with their own theories about stuttering, believed it had to do something with breastfeeding or oral fixations or other things with it. This is a quote from a 1960s textbook about stuttering. That stuttering results from thoroughly unresolved pregenital oral sadistic conflict. I'm a board-certified psychiatrist, and I don't know what that means. So it means something, but they were way off and actually got people away from actually seeking medical care for their stuttering. They would go, they'd get this type of treatment, and it had no real benefit, and it kind of died. So psychiatrists kind of got out of really the realm of treating stuttering. It was left primarily to speech-language pathologists and to that area. So now we're just seeing kind of a reemergence back into the medical aspects of stuttering for the treatment of this disorder. I was in medical school, and we had a lecture on Tourette's disorder. And as I was listening to that lecture, I said, you know, this kind of sounds like me. So Tourette's is less common than stuttering, but it's studied more and accepted more in the medical community about treatments. So how Tourette's and stuttering, they're both associated with tic motions, where people get like eye blinks or facial grimaces that they may, or tension in their muscles. They follow a waxing, waning course. Kids who stutter and kids with Tourette's, they have good weeks and bad weeks. It comes and goes. They both are made worse by anxiety or stress. They're both more common in males than females. There's a 4-to-1 male to female ratio. It begins in childhood. The symptoms are worsened by medicines that increase the brain chemical of dopamine, and they tend to get better by medicines that block dopamine in the brain. They can be related, we believe, now to abnormalities, a certain region of the brain called the basal ganglia. There's even a genetic linkage that's been postulated between Tourette's and stuttering as well. So the etiology of stuttering is, we believe there's a strong genetic component. More work is being done on that. We also believe there's an abnormal development of certain brain regions, specifically the basal ganglia. We'll get into that. And the white matter tracks how the nerve cells communicate together in the brain. There even may be an autoimmune component. We have one case report of that, which shows you that a child who has an infection at a young age that may, who's predisposed to stuttering, that may attack, that antibody against that infection may attack the developing brain and lead to stuttering. I don't think this is the cause of all stuttering, but maybe a cause of some a minority of cases of individuals who stutter. And these are disorders that are a little better defined in Tourette's, an obsessive compulsive disorder called PANDAS, or pediatric autoimmune neurologic disorders associated with streptococcus. So it's an autoimmune condition where the child actually has an infection, strep throat, and we know that strep throat at times can attack the heart. They have the antibody attack the heart, but there's some thoughts that it can even attack the developing brain. So a child who's at that right or wrong age, though you define it, can get the antibody attack to what's the infection is in the throat or ears or wherever, then attack the developing brain and lead potentially to stuttering. So it's been established more in Tourette's, and OCD has not been fully established in stuttering, but we've described it at least. Now, many individuals who stutter have gone on to achieve great things. Namely, you know, King George VI, who's Queen Elizabeth's father. This is Queen Elizabeth's father. He was a king during World War II. You've probably seen the movie The King's Speech. Had lunch with a gentleman who was a screenwriter for The King's Speech. David Sadler's his name. Very nice man. I think he might have been the oldest gentleman to win his first Academy Award. I think he was in his 70s at the time. Screenwriter. He had been... He wrote the screenplay years ago. He wrote it probably 25 to 30 years ago. He had approached and got permission from Lionel Logue, a therapist, from his grandson to review all the diaries that Mr. Logue had on King George VI. He reviewed that, he wrote the screenplay, had it sold. He went to the Queen Mother, Queen Elizabeth's mom, who figures prominently in the film, and asked her, "Now, Your Highness, may I have your permission? This movie features you prominently. It features your husband, of course, who since passed away. And I said, you know, may I have your permission to make this movie?" And she replies, just not during my lifetime. My husband's stuttering was very painful for me. I don't want to really be remembered, but yeah, my permission. She lived to be 103. Right? So the poor guy, he kept his word. He battled colon cancer and prostate cancer. He was really drawn. He's a person who stutters himself. He's Jewish, and his family fled in World War II. They came over to New York, and his father was still listening to the radio broadcast somehow. And his son grew up idolizing his king, and so kind of eventually he moved back to the UK and everything with that. But I didn't really know about King George VI as a little boy who stuttered. That really wasn't my role model that I had. I'm glad that children today who stutter can look to that movie and understand there's a great world leader, someone who stutters. I had this person. I had Porky Pig. And I had to look up to Porky. That's all I had. Of course, I had to look up to a swine. There's one thing to be said to that. But the worst thing for this is, you know, Porky wears a nice, you know, vest and tie. But he wears no pants, and he has no genitals. So that's like the worst thing for me, really, as a never mind, right? So Porky puts the pants on, you know, like, come on, Warner Brothers. Like, you got this nice tie, never mind. But you don't see him on too much anymore, right? People know. It was actually my group, before I was on the board, the National Stuttering Association had a big protest over Porky with that. And Porky is not so much on as much as he was anymore. So through PET and SPECT imaging, we began to understand the measurement of the metabolism of the living brain. I love to cite these two authors. Wood and Stump got together in 1980, and they investigated the effects of haloperidol, which is a medication for the treatment of stuttering at that point. It was not FDA approved for that, but they found that improved fluency associated with certain activities of the speech areas. Then Poole and Watson and DeVoe and others, they did an MRI study, and they found that there were these areas of the brain that seemed to be not functioning normally in the brains of who's stutter. It does appear that the left hemispheric speech areas are less active than analogous areas of the right hemisphere. And this has been, so what Travis and Orton were saying back in 1927 appears to be right. And it appears that the right side compensates for the underactive left side. Like normally, in a right-handed person, the left hemisphere controls the speech. And for some reason, in a child who stutters, that doesn't fully develop. But over years, the adult who stutters can compensate somewhat for their stuttering by developing the other hemisphere to pick up the speech that seems to be not functioning well. Study that I did as a resident back at UC Irvine, we found that stuttering was associated with a slow activity of certain speech cortical areas and the striatum. And Heather, you can look at the ethics of this because I was my own subject. I had no money for this. I was still a resident. And when there was extra radioactive isotope, I actually had IRB approval, but when I had extra radioactive isotope was when I would inject. So I like injected. I know that's probably crazy. It was like 1995. Like, okay, girl, let me scan my brain. Right? I did that, so I'm one of these subjects. I don't think anybody looked in those days, but that's an ethical consideration for you on that. I served about it with that, and we did two tasks for people who stutter, because people who stutter can be made fluent if they sing, right? You sing, remember the country singer Mel Tillis, his daughter Pam Tillis is a singer, but Mel himself, he's fluent when he sings. I forgot also to mention that James Earl Jones, maybe the best voice of our day, is a person who stutters. And most of his movies, they edit out his own stuttering, but it's almost like a disguised voice for him that this is CNN. If you disguise your voice, your speech can be fluent. And it can also be fluent if you're reading aloud with another person at the same time. It's called chorus reading. And as a little boy growing up in the Catholic Church, I'd go to Mass, and we'd say the prayers or whatever, and I'd be fluent, and because I'd be like, oh, Father, pardon heaven, but I'm totally fine. I'd leave the church, and I'd start stuttering again. I'd say to myself, God, there's some divine intervention in that building. I don't really quite understand why, but never mind, that's what you get at age 5. And Ross would like this. I was kicked out of catechism because I was listening to the Giants-Padres game on my transistor radio, and never mind. I was like, they, you know, almost didn't get Holy Communion because of that, Ross, but never mind. So we actually looked at stuttering. These are brains of individuals who stutter compared to controls, and this is a higher group. We actually look at the brain this way, and a more active area shows red on the graph. It's taking up more glucose. We measured fluorodeoxyglucose, so brain activity, and we're measuring people reading out loud alone. So we're having people who read and they're stuttering at that time. And we had controls doing the same thing. So an area of the brain that's active when you're doing a task will try to light up red because that brain area is active. So here you see here, there's more red, as you notice, in the control, people who don't stutter brain. And this is a subtraction, this image from this image. Specifically, these are the regions that are at a threshold of 0.05. Wernicke's area, an area of the basal ganglia called the striatum, was very low in people who stutter. Broca's area. We then take those same people who stutter, here they are reading aloud alone. Now they're reading aloud with another person at the same time. So they're fluent. And since I had to sit through all these and score all the rating scales, I said, well, I got to learn something. So I was having him read Golf Digest. I thought, well, maybe that way my golf game would get a little, but my golf game was still bad. But I thought I would have him do that. And they actually improved their speech. This shows you that the people who stutter, their approach to the real, almost like the control brain. They look almost like the normal brain. When they are reading aloud with another person, they become fluent. Wernicke's area goes up. The Broca's area goes up. But conspicuous by its absence, the striatum stay the same. So it tells you that there seems to be a trait phenomenon. There's some defect potentially there in the striatum region of the brain. But the people who stutter can activate the cortical areas to bypass that area. We do know from other research there are two loops of speech, an inner loop of speech and an outer loop of speech that leads to speech fluency. The striatum is an area. What happens with Wernicke's area is we understand what word we want to say. We time and initiate it in the striatum, and then we form the word in Broca's area. People who stutter have difficulty using it at the beginning of the phrase, the beginning of the word, not the end of the phrase, and the timing of their speech. This is that internal timer. If they have an external timer, like someone else is reading along with them, or if they're speaking, if they're having rhythm with poetry or singing, they can bypass this internal timer and get the normal flow pattern in their speech. We then also measured the dopamine scans. We measured, because we know striatum is a dopamine-rich area, we measured the activity of brains of people who stutter with the dopamine system, and we actually measured the presynaptic dopamine activity. We found that people who stutter are about two, there's more red here, people who stutter were about 200% higher of their dopamine levels compared to controls. So this led to kind of the understanding that maybe dopamine is involved in the stuttering brain. There's also some other understanding that we knew from older studies that some of the medicines that block dopamine tend to improve stuttering, and some medicines that increase this brain chemical can make stuttering worse. For instance, in ADD, the stimulant medicines that are often used for attention deficit disorder can worsen stuttering in a child, for instance. So this gets us to come learn about, could this lead us up to pharmacologic treatment? So if we understand the treatment of the stuttering, if it may be related to this brain chemical, can we modify that level of activity, the brain chemical? Could we improve stuttering? So no medicine is FDA approved for stuttering. And with that, we're going to review what medicines have been tried, what's reviewed. I'll be going into a little bit of an ethics behind this, because to really get a medication FDA approved for the government, you got to submit a lot of data, you got to do these clinical trials that Heather knows. You've seen the budget just for our side of the clinical trials. It may be $300 to $400 million to actually get a medication through all the clinical trials and then submit to the Food and Drug Administration and get it approved to be marketed as stuttering. So the gold standard is an FDA approved medication. So we have published studies that some medicines can improve stuttering, but no one can go out and market it and sell those medications without an FDA indication. And the studies of the medicines I'm going to cite you are generic. So you can go out there and buy them for, you know, pennies a pill. So there's no financial incentive really for someone to get behind investing $400 to $500 million for one of those medicines coming to market. So you almost have to look at something that has a patent life that's long, and you test that, and hopefully you get funding. You might get funding from NIH, like we're getting some philanthropic funding as a startup. But eventually this brings us to where we have some IP on this one product here at UCR, but we don't have to almost get like venture capital or big pharma or someone else to partner with to license it, to bring it forward, who could invest the $300 to $400 million. So again, that's just kind of my thought about how do you ever bring something to market? See how this is kind of the understanding of the ethics behind that? Like, you really can't get something that's FDA approved unless someone invests in it to go through the process. But to get that investment, you have to partner with someone who's going to profit on it. And that's a real struggle that I have in our system. But we'll review that and kind of give you the background of where things are. Haloperidol has been a medicine that's been around since 1955. It's generic. There were studies in the 1970s that it improved stuttering, but there were a lot of side effects to it. There's side effects to it, so people decided not to take it, never really ever caught on. There was also a study that was done from NIH. I was already doing my research at this time, and they tried to prove me wrong. They want to say that stuttering was related to serotonin, another chemical, not to dopamine. So they tested a dopamine-blocking medicine called pimazide, compared to a serotonin medicine called paroxetine, which is an antidepressant medicine, and they found the opposite. Paroxetine did not help, but pimazide did improve stuttering. And pimazide is a dopamine-related compound, but it has a lot of side effects. It makes patients stiff, rigid, make them depressed. It can raise one of the blood hormones, etc. So that led to me testing. There were some new medicines. The dopamine-blocking medicines are approved for schizophrenia and bipolar disorder. So I was going to test these medicines in stuttering. These are supported by philanthropic funds that we had at UC Irvine, but I also received what's called independent grants from the companies that made the medicines as well. They didn't influence the content, but I received the medications from them and the matching placebo. It's not like I could go out and make placebo or medicines, right? So you have to somehow get them. And so we had those contracts. These studies were done at UC Irvine was at the time, and we did these studies. This was published in 2000. Of risperidone, it's a medication that's generic now. It was a 16-subject study. We did really the gold standard of any clinical trial is called double-blind placebo control. So I don't know what the patient's taking. The patient doesn't know, but it could be a fake pill or a real pill. And we have objective ratings. And I have a rating who doesn't look at the patient. It's a videotape rating of their speech sample. Because the patient may come and say, God, I'm really tired today. Since I've been on this medicine, I'm so tired. That could bias you that maybe he's on the real stuff. Because if he's on placebo, he wouldn't be so tired. So it could be a side effect of the risperidone. So the rater is someone, we have a 10-minute session, he's reading out loud, and the rater is someone else at another university who's doing the score. So in our current study, we have a rater at the University of Redlands who's reviewing all our videotapes and audio tapes of the patients to make sure she's not biased in actually meeting with the subjects and being told that, you know, like some of these medicines can cause weight gain. So if she knows she's just seeing the patient from up here, like if he says, you know, I've gained 20 pounds, I'm eating too much, that could bias her to one way or the other from the medication standpoint. So risperidone worked. It worked better than placebo. And we tested it on the percentage of syllables stuttered, the percentage of time stuttered. So this shows you that the rating, these are the effects of patients on placebo, these are the effects of the patient on medication, this percentage of syllables stuttered. So we rated that, the duration of each time like that approach. This is a global score, the SSI-3, showing an improvement over placebo. Now, placebo patients get a little better. That's another interesting thing. And I think it's an artifact of me meeting with them and my team meeting with them for 4 or 5 visits talking about their stuttering. I think the first visit, they might be a little more anxious. Remember, anxiety makes stuttering worse. So they're getting a little better each visit. And so placebo patients can get better, too. That's always been kind of a bias in studies. You have to prove you're better than placebo. So this method, we were able to show we were statistically better than placebo with it. We also did an imaging scan showing that people on the medication had a greater activity in that striatal area. This is the left side here. The striatal area actually went up. So we actually have a marker to show that the speech actually got better. We tested olanzapine, and it showed that it improved stuttering as well, too. It's a similar mechanism as risperidone. We also then, from a placebo response, we showed the same placebo response on the objective rating, but we did a subjective scale. And the subjective scale, where the patients rated their own speech, was a scale, how would you rate your speech today versus yesterday, et cetera. No placebo response. Didn't get any better. But they rated their speech better. So really almost, it's good because they may say, yeah, I'm fine with you, Dr. McGuire, by my 5th time seeing you. But I still stutter in front of my boss. I still stutter running out the bar and trying to ask somebody out, things like that. Still there. So this nice subjective scale really showed that there's really no placebo response for that as well. We did see weight gain. So this medicine could lead to side effects, make patients sedated, a weight gain. Never got FDA approved. No one ever invested hundreds of millions of dollars to do that. There's some ethics behind this. The study of this one was, and I approached the company to see if they would invest in it. They were selling a lot of this, and they price it per dose. So the dose that we use in stuttering is maybe 1/10 of the dose for acute schizophrenia or bipolar. And I approached them. I went back to their headquarters and said, listen, you know, you've seen some good data. Would you approach this? They were afraid that If we get a new indication, doctors may start prescribing a lower dose, and they would actually then stop, their sales would go down. So this is another ethical thought, which is it kind of stalls the research, because if it ultimately is going to affect sales of something, it may not actually happen. Does that make some sense? So that's kind of what I heard through the background. I made a great presentation and went back there. I was really trying to sell it a little bit. But you really almost, by that point, you're not dealing with scientists. You're dealing with financial people. You might be dealing with a marketing department. There might be dealing like, how can I make money off this idea? So that's a potential problem with things. We tested just in a few patients acetapine. We do have some data to support that medication as well. Aripiprazole, we have a couple of cases with that as well. I want to talk about this study. Pagliclone was a study that we actually went through the process of an FDA trial. And we went through phase 3. It was a compound that was discovered by accident when they were testing patients with panic disorder. Their stuttering got better. So they approached me at UC Irvine. We had a consulting agreement that I had through UC Irvine, which was that I was going to design the protocol for them. So we designed the protocol for them. We are going to test this at 300 subjects around the country. We had about 30 centers around the country. We got them all together. We trained them all on how to use the different rating scales, et cetera. Didn't even get an ad out in the newspaper. Word started spreading on the internet that we were going to test a new medication for stuttering. Guess how quickly we enrolled 300 subjects across the country? 2 weeks. Without any advertising. Just the word of mouth that there could be a medicine to help stuttering. Shows you how hungry people are for this, right? So what's interesting, I was going to be one of the lead sites for the study. And as you know, UC contrast can take a little bit of time. So here I am, I designed the protocol, I'm waiting around. And then I get a call. You got enrolled subjects by Friday because we've already met our enrollment. I said, what? We haven't even got anybody. So I made sure I got my IRB approved. I got like 10 subjects in and we got it. So I was actually participating in the trial. But it shows you how desperate people were for this. So they actually invested. This was a little company, a little biotech company. They had partnered with a big pharma called Teva. They're an Israeli company. And they funded that research. So we were under contract. It was a sponsored clinical trial where the university was under contract by the industry to test this medication. We didn't own the IP because we did not think of this use. It's not like we thought of it. They thought of it and came to us at UC to design the study and to put it out there. So that's what we did. There was some thought that it could work. This was a study design. We started with this low dose. They based it upon their panic disorder dose. And we have these various different rating scales. We showed an improvement compared to placebo in the study, but you see the placebo response gaining after week 8. This is looking at the CGI severity. It really worked well for anxiety. Really worked well for social anxiety. It doesn't work on dopamine. It works on GABA, which is an anxiety type neurotransmitter. So it really didn't help the fluency of speech, but helped the anxiety. So when we submitted it to the FDA, our primary, when you do a study for the FDA, you have what's called the primary endpoint. And we said our primary endpoint is going to be syllables who stutter. Our secondary endpoint is going to be the Liebowitz social anxiety scale. We're going to look at this in the background. This showed a statistical improvement. When we go back here, the syllables who stuttered, we started showing an improvement, but it didn't necessarily last, and it doesn't have a strong effect as it did on anxiety. So they had to go back to the drawing board. We went back and said, you know what, based upon the other studies, it could probably work better, and we'd probably get more of an effect size, but we have to go higher on the dose. This is back about 2008. We're all set. Seemed to work pretty well, especially on social anxiety. We increased the dose, and we saw that as we moved on to the open label phase, the placebo control group was catching up to the group. And you see that the placebo, so even though the medication continued to improve visit to visit, the patients were getting more comfortable in the setting. So a lot of the finance people said, I don't think we'd ever get this through the FDA because you're not that much stronger than placebo, even though there's an effect of the drug. Right? So it's 2008. What happened back to the economy back then? Your stock price just goes way down, right? Goes way down. The company, a little biotech company that I was working with, all the guy people I work with, they got bought. Someone else comes in and buys them. they had other technology for like an implantable medicine that you can implant where for psychosis. And they wanted to buy that. And the company that bought them, we're not interested. We don't even care about Stuttering. We don't care about Stuttering. So I go back to Philadelphia. I meet with these guys. Like, hey, you know, I think if you bump the dose higher or you went to the social anxiety scale, I think you get this FDA approved. We don't have the funding to do it. Sitting on what I thought was a pretty decent medicine, study stopped. Makes some sense, right? Because now you're dealing with finance people, the economy is poor, where are they going to invest in their product? They're laying off people. Why invest $300 or $400 in this stuff? And here's the next thing. They got their marketing people behind it. And what they did, they call market research. And they go out and they poll a bunch of physicians and they say, how much Stuttering do you see? And if you had a treatment, would you use it? And the vast majority of physicians said, I don't see Stuttering. So they didn't think there's much of a market. Now, what's interesting, though, Teva, the company that originally invested that pulled out, they've seen that because they asked different marketing questions. They asked the Stuttering community. They went to the direct. Now, there's always been some a little bit of a, how do I say, a debate whether we should have direct-to-consumer advertising about medications, right? Think about that. But this is one where I think it might be helpful because the doctors don't know about Stuttering. People who stutter don't go to an MD. They go to a speech language pathologist. They're not going at all. So you almost have to increase awareness that, hey, there's something out there for you, and you got to go out and get it. So we're working on a new compound. I'll talk about that a little bit. I've already thought of the brand name, though. Are you guys ready for it? You guys ready? You want to hear it now? Let's get it on record. Maybe we can trademark it. Conversol. Ask your doctor if Conversol is right for you. Side effects may include impotence, coma, or death. I've already got it. It'll be good. It'll be patented here from UCR. Never mind, right? So I wanted to go higher on the dose, but we never went there. With it was tolerated well, but the funding ceased. And now, the patent of this drug runs out by 2020. There's no way anybody's going to invest. It's going to take them 2 years to get through the FDA, and they can only make money off it for a year. So they look at these life cycle that when you develop a product, and they say, okay, if we have like $500 million a year in sales or whatever it might be, and they project, are we going to make up that money? Is there enough profit for us to, you know what I'm saying, by the time they hire everybody? So you almost have to be a little bit of a finance person if you're going to look at an FDA indication. What about other treatment considerations? We do know that in ADHD, sometimes I remove a medicine that may stuttering worse, because that could be done. We've even done a couple of cases of deep brain implants, and Dr. Binder with us here at UCR is a deep brain implant surgeon. We've done one patient. This went through the IRB at Irvine when we did this. This was a case of a person who had the deep brain implant for another condition. So we weren't testing it specifically in stuttering. So she had it for another condition, but she also, after the stutter, we saw an improvement. That case has been replicated in France. This is where we place a probe deep in that striatal region of the brain. It's very invasive. So this is something that you haven't even seen this yet. We're not even submitting this yet. But this, what we're going to do, what you've seen is the beginning of this, which is we're going to do a brain imaging study with Dr. Xiaoping Hu on campus. We have a new imaging center on campus. You know the imaging studies I was showing you? We want to do more brain imaging and track that area of the brain that we think is abnormal in stuttering and really pinpoint it down to a certain area. And then if you could you stimulate that area with a probe? Could you stimulate it through a magnetic current? So our beginning of this is to do more imaging that we're going to do here at UCR, our new imaging center, and hopefully identify a region of the brain, a circumscribed region, that may be a target, and when we're reasonably assured, we can go in there, and it's worth the potential risk of doing that. So, we're going to test another study that was going on at UCR right now, where we have the philanthropic support that's been donated to UCR, but we do have the medications made by the biotech company. They're sending it to it. This drug called Ecopipam. We have some subjects enrolled right now, and we don't have the results yet, so I'm hopeful to have those results by the springtime, but we won't do it. We're going to have to present it at a national meeting, get it published, and then go from there, but that's kind of an interesting one. TMS is a transcranial magnetic stimulating. We're not doing that study there, but again, we always come up with how do we accurately assess the changes in the stuttering severity given the placebo response. So we're adding more subjective ratings in here, And we are we're still keeping that blind reader. We're partnering with the University of Redlands on this as well. But these are all studies in adults, because ethically, I have not tested these medications in adolescents. Again, the consenting for an adolescent, even though stuttering begins in childhood, when can an adolescent consent to a research medication? Right? So we have, these are all studies on people over the age of 18. Yet this is a disorder that really profoundly affects adolescents. So I think what we have to do is show improvement in adults first and really verify that before we would consider using it in someone else who is not age 18, who may not be able to consent to treatment with it. There's even some work out at NIH that there's maybe something with the lysosomal storage. There's even some different types of talk therapy that may be better. But I do think, you know, we also have a clinical program here at UCR where we're partnering with speech language pathology and others, and we're developing that to actually treat people potentially if they want these medications. I've shown you medicines that they are on the market. They are technically off-label. They're not on-label by the FDA, but they are proven to be effective for schizophrenia, bipolar, and Tourette's. So we can use these off-label if a patient, an adult patient, consents to that, and we can consider that. So I really think the combination therapy of speech therapy, medications, it's always this, I don't really propose what Dr. Gallagher is doing here, simultaneously confronting the fear of heights, snakes in the dark. But UCR has been a great friend of the stuttering community, and I want to thank all of you for coming today, and I'll open up for any questions if you have them. So thank you all. His mind's going faster than his mouth, is what people tell you, right? Is there anybody else in the family who stutters? Okay. Did he have any infections around that time? Strep throat or anything? Watch it, but you know what? It's always a good idea, because if it does persist, studies have shown that getting him into speech therapy at a young age can rewire that brain and get him into treatment now, at least get him assessed by a good speech-language pathologist. I can recommend Dr. Lisa LaSalle at University of Redlands, right down the road. Now, you live where? Where do you live? Area. Okay, so I will go to the University of Redlands, give them a call there at their communication disorders department. Certainly wouldn't help for him to be evaluated and assessed. He could very likely just outgrow it. Let him, okay, here's what, the first thing is, like, just let him speak their mind. Let him finish your own word. The worst thing would do is to finish his word for him.
Okay.
Yeah, that's okay. But we always do it. Let him get through it. And also say, you know, bring him to Dr. LaSalle or one of her grad students and others. You know, let's get him seen, and then they'll really coach you on how to deal with it. It appears to be, yeah. I've been on one of these medicines for 21 years. Yeah. I think so. I think, you can see how it goes, but I'm not sure this is a curative treatment. It's kind of a covering up the deficiency. It's not to say that these medicines aren't without long-term side effects, so they need to be under a physician's care. You need to monitor for weight gain and lipid elevations and changes in movement disorders and other. Time and situations almost even more. People who stutter really hate using the telephone. They tend to avoid it. Because no one on the other end knows that they're stuttering. So he's voice activated. I've had to talk to my compliance office about my patients. They text me. Where do I talk to you about it? They don't use the phone. They email, they text, they won't pick up a phone and call. And you understand why. So we almost have to accommodate for them in another way. So telephones are horrible. They really have trouble on words they can't substitute. So saying their own name. So time of day, people who stutter tend to get worse if they haven't had sleep. So if they've gone a night without sleep, that tends to be worse for them. But usually situation versus time of day. Situation where they can't substitute the word, speak in front of a group, telephone, can be really hard for them. Thank you all very much. If I could ever be a benefit, here's my email address. So So thank you all very much, everybody.